Good evening. Today my guest on the world today is Gorka Eleja Barrieta, representative of the radical left group Sortu from the Basque Country in Spain. The history of the Basque Country has been a tormented one for many, many years. It's not an easy history, it's a complex one. And so we're very glad Gorka is with us in the studio to unravel the situation for us, because with elections due in Spain later on in the year, what happens in the large nations that comprise Spain will be important. Just like Catalonia, the Basque Country is a nation. That is undeniable. Gorka, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
ETA became one of the best known guerrilla groups in Europe. I mean, there were others. There was the Irish Republican Army, which actually didn't resume the conflict till the 70s. But ETA started an armed resistance to Franco. In which year?
When ETA was founded in 1958, it started especially with political, cultural actions. And later, those actions, they developed into armed actions. I will say that one of the main and most known actions of ETA in that period became the assassination of Carrero Blanco in 1973, which was at that time seen as an appointed also by Franco as
he was Franco's prime minister.
That's it. It was Franco's prime minister, and he was appointed as his political successor once Franco died. At that time, ETA was seen both internally in the Basque Country and in the Spanish state, and also externally in the international community, as the main dissident movement against the Francoist regime, with the strongest capacity, military and political capacity, as well as popular support.
And tell me, is it not the case that during that period of the Franco dictatorship, ETA got a lot of support from social democratic politicians in Europe, from liberals, who felt that this was the only resistance to Franco?
In 1970, there was a court case, which was known as the Burgos trial, against several members of ETA. This court case arise internationally the support for ETA, and it also arise the solidarity against those forces within the Spanish state fighting against Franco. And that support brought the support of many intellectual, many governments all around Europe and Latin America especially. I've seen pictures of Olof Palme marching in the streets of Stockholm against the Burgos trial, for example. The second one is, as I said at the beginning, the assassination of Carrero Blanco, which was internationally also seen as a hit against the Francoist regime. And the last and third one was in 1975, the execution of three FRAP members together with two ETA members. These three events together arose an international consciousness on two issues. First, the need for a profound change in the Spanish state policies, international support against the Francoist regime, and the second, also support for those nations within the Spanish state, especially the Basque Country and Catalonia, for their right to self-determination.
But after the end of the Cold War, or even before it, with the death of Franco, there was now a carefully orchestrated transition to democratic rule, which imposed a monarchy on Spain, which brought Spain into NATO, and which created a system in which the conservatives and the social democrats increasingly began to resemble each other. Now, why was it that the Basque parties were excluded from this deal?
As a prominent Spanish politician put it at that time, they needed to change everything so that nothing will change. It was a makeup transition operation. There was possibility for change, that was clear to us at that time. But that change could be done in two different, very different, I will say, ways. The first one, a makeup operation, so that nothing will really change, that everything will stay
the same.
And the second, so that was a reform of the Francoist system, a pure reform. And the second was what we consider had to be the best option, which was a rupture, a break.
A total break
with the Francoist regime, a democratization of the Spanish state. Unfortunately, we stood almost alone in that position. And we saw at that time that the majority of political forces in the Spanish state, they went for the reform. And now we are paying the decisions that were done at that time. We are still paying for that decision.
When did ETA decide to cease the armed struggle?
ETA decided to end its armed campaign in October 2011.
Why did it take such a long time?
When it comes to nations like the Basque Country, Catalonia, and others, the right to decide, the right to self-determination of our peoples was not recognized. Prisons in Spain during the transition were emptied, but there was no one single day without a political prisoner in a Spanish gaol. Just after the amnesty law was approved, again, repression continued and prisoners started again to be arrested. The reason for that is that in the principle, nothing had politically changed. And we were still in a situation, in a scenario on which we were not able to democratically work or fight or actively promote our political ideas. And this is the main reason for the political conflict, including the armed confrontation, to continue for such a long period of time.
Were there discussions inside ETA for some time on how to end it or not?
As far as I know, there has been a continuous discussion during these 35, 40 years in the site of ETA, and also as a whole in the Basque, in the different Basque political actors, on whether it was right or wrong to continue with the armed struggle. That's a continuous debate within any revolutionary group, I will say.
This is true, and of course, you know, the reason I'm asking is because a similar debate erupted inside the IRA after they began negotiations, and even before that, what are we going to do now with the change? Yeah. Because interestingly, unlike the Spanish ruling elite, the British state began to have secret discussions with the IRA after the IRA made a very audacious attempt to, you know, they bombed the Brighton Hotel, and the aim was to destroy the entire Conservative government, including Margaret Thatcher. I mean, her cabinet ministers were injured. So despite the horror by Conservatives especially, but also people in general, that this is not the way to proceed, despite all that, the British state didn't try and wipe out the IRA. They in fact opened channels of communication and started negotiating with them. Did anything of this sort happen between the Spanish state and ETA?
Every prime minister in office in Spain since the death of Franco has publicly always promised never to talk to ETA. And I have to say that all of them, but the actual prime minister Rajoy, all of them, they have at one point or another sit on a table to negotiate with ETA the end of the conflict. So there have been possibilities, there have been scenarios on which the resolution of the conflict could have been achieved. the most prominent peace processes that we had had in the Basque country since the death of Franco were the process with the government of Felipe González in the late 80s that took place in Algiers. Then I will say the process in the late 90s, which was of a different kind. It was not a process on which was based solely on a bilateral dialogue and negotiation process between it and the Spanish government, but on a dialogue and negotiation process between political forces in the Basque country, and that was known at that time as the Lizarra-Garazi process. It was a process that started with an agreement between Batasuna, the party of the Basque National Liberation Movement at that time, and the PNB, including other parties as well, but basically those two. And then we had the third most serious attempt, I would say, in 2006 and 2007 with the
Zapatero.
Yeah. So there have been attempts in the past to solve the conflict. There had been direct and indirect talks.
What has been the sticking point, the obstruction to the solution, in your opinion?
In my opinion, the main obstruction to the solution has always been the same: the lack of willingness from the Spanish state to recognize the Basque country as a political entity with the right to decide. The main obstacle to reach peace in the Basque country has to be seen on the roots of the conflict, not only on the consequences that this conflict has brought, but especially on the roots of the conflict.
Yeah, but Gorka, the attitude of the Spanish state to Catalonia is not so different. They refuse to recognize the right of the Catalan people to self-determination.
They have always told us, if violence disappears in the Basque country, you will have the possibility to pursue whatever political objective you have, if you have the support of the majority in your country. We are seeing in Catalonia that is not the case. The Catalan people has promoted for several years now a process on which the absolute majority of Catalans agrees that Catalonia should have a say, should have the possibility to decide upon their future freely and democratically through a referendum. Spain is not willing to accept that. I still remember that when the Catalan government announced that a referendum was going to be organized in Catalonia, the vice president of the European Parliament, who at that time was a Spanish PP politician, Alejo Vidal Cuadras, said in a TV or a radio interview, he said that if he was the prime minister of Spain, he will appoint a general brigade in Catalonia to prevent this referendum from happening.
Gorka, returning to the Basque country, the armed struggle organizations declared a unilateral ceasefire in 2011. That's sort of 4 years ago. What was the response since then?
When the peace process with Zapatero collapsed, we started within our movement an internal debate to analyze what went wrong during the process, but especially to decide what we were going to do in the future, to establish a new strategy for us to reach our political goals. In that debate, the Abertzale left, the Basque National Liberation Movement, took a new strategy. And that new strategy brought our embrace to purely democratic and peaceful means. We consider at that time, and I'm speaking about 2009, 2010, we came to the conclusion that there was no room for political violence in our country, that political violence was preventing us from achieving our political agenda. We, during all that internal debate process, we consulted and we spoke with friends and with other parties within the Basque country and also within the international community. And as a conclusion of that, we took that decision. And that was a unilateral decision. And that brought, in 2011, an international conference in the Basque country. That was called the International Conference of Aiete. It took place in Donostia, San Sebastian. And at that conference, we met for the first time under the same roof, representatives from most of the political parties in the Basque Country in the south, all political parties but the PP, representatives of the main trade unions as well, but also representatives from every political party of the north of the Basque Country, including UMP, the party of Sarkozy, including the Parti Socialiste, the party of Hollande, and us. And we met together with representatives of the international community, including Jonathan Powell, Desmond Tutu, Bertie Ahern, Thierry Adams, Gro Harlem Brundtland, and Pierre Joxe. At that conference, the international community released a roadmap for the resolution of the conflict. That roadmap included five points. On the first point, they asked ETA to end its armed campaign. And unlike in previous peace processes, they did not ask ETA for a ceasefire, but they asked ETA for the end of the armed campaign. Then they asked Spain and France to respond in a positive way to this decision and to start a dialogue process with ETA on the consequences of the conflict. And by consequences of the conflict, we mean the issue of victims, prisoners, people on the run, disarmament, and the militarization of the conflict. And then they ask political parties in the Basque Country to start a dialogue process to look into the roots of the conflict, to agree on which has to be the path of the Basque Country from nowadays scenario into a more democratic scenario. This conference was done in October 2011. A month later, there were elections in Spain. So this conference was done while the Socialist Party was still in government in Madrid. And a month later, there was a change of government and Rajoy, the Partido Popular, the Conservative Party of Spain, took office. We believe the Spanish government is interested in the past conflict to continue. We believe they are blocking the process, the development of the process, because that prevents us from developing our political agenda fully. They know that if we are able to solve the conflict, especially the consequences of the conflict, we will have a new scenario in the Basque Country on which political parties, social movements, popular struggles will bring the Basque Country to a similar scenario of that
of Sinn Féin in Ireland, for instance,
or of that going on in Catalonia. And they want to prevent another Catalonia from happening.
So you think, in your opinion, the principal reason for the Spanish Conservatives blocking a permanent peace settlement in Spain between the Spanish state and the Basque Country is to prolong uncertainty and to crush any movements to sort of divide the state?
Yes, I mean, Spain is going through
a very important crisis.
Economic, institutional, political crisis. It is clear, or it looks to us at least, that there has to be a second transition in Spain. It is not clear yet whether that will happen or not, and it is not clear if it happens what kind of change we will have. It could be that they change, it's just a makeup operation and nothing change. But there is an opportunity also for a democratic profound change in the Spanish state. And the conflict in the Basque Country is still an issue that the Spanish state is using to prevent this change from happening.
How many political prisoners are there still in the Basque Country?
We still have more than 400 political prisoners through prisons in Spain and in France. Majority of prisoners, and by majority I mean more than 90% of the prisoners, they are serving their sentences in prisons in Spain and France, not in the Basque Country.
But have you appealed to the European Court of Justice and these institutions demanding their release? Because given there's a ceasefire now, there's no war going on.
Yeah, I mean, we Basque, we are known for disagreeing between us in almost everything. There is a say that says if you put two Basques together, you will probably have three political parties. But There are only three things on which opinion polls are showing during the years that we Basques are agreeing. And this includes nationalist and non-nationalist, includes left and right. And those three things are, first, that the Basque country should have the right to decide.
Its
second,
future, yeah.
There should be a peace process in the Basque country based on dialogue and agreement. And third, that the issue of prisoners has to be
resolved.
And especially on the issue of the dispersal policy and exceptional measures that are being implemented against Basque prisoners, there is a general support for that to be changed. And that it's within the Basque country. And we work and we struggle in a permanent way, campaigning for that situation to change. We also have brought this issue several times to the European Court of Human Rights, to United Nations, and there have been several condemnations from different international bodies to the Spanish state on the issue of, especially of how or the policies they implement against Basque prisoners, and also on the violation of human rights against Basque activists.
How do you see the rise of Podemos in relation, leaving aside other issues, in relation to the national question?
Well, for us, Podemos means two things. First, it seems to be something different, and there was need for a different and progressive movement in Spain. That has to be said. And it also means a lot of uncertainty. Uncertainty, that's it. Because it's not clear yet what they stand for. But as far as we have, as we know, Podemos has publicly said two things which are important for us. They have said that the right to decide of the peoples within the Spanish state has to be respected. They have said that we have to move from a situation on which the Spanish government imposed a decision to Catalonia and the Basque Country to a different one on which Spain has to seduce Spain and Catalonia to remain together. But taking it clear that the right, the decision of Catalans and Basques has to be respected. And the second thing is Pablo Iglesias said recently, I think it was in an interview with yourself, that the exceptional measures against Basque political prisoners have to be
not accepted,
and that there was need for a peace process based in dialogue and negotiation. So
we see what happens in the Spanish elections at the end of this year, which will be quite decisive, because even if no single party gets a majority, in my opinion, that's positive.
Yeah, that's already a positive thing. We don't know who will win the elections. We don't know what will be the result. There are many different opinion polls, but one thing is clear: no party will have absolute majority, and that will bring a need for agreements and a different kind of government. Again, in our opinion, we face an opportunity like the one we faced at the end of Francoism. There is possibility for change.
Tell me a bit about Sortu, your organization.
Well, Sortu is a party that was established in 2011. It was immediately banned by the Spanish courts, but after a year, finally the Supreme or the Constitutional Court legalized it. Sortu is a party that was born to represent politically the Basque National Liberation Movement. We stand for the independence and socialism of the Basque countries. We see those two fights as the two sides of the same coin. We are a party that is organized nationally in the Basque Country, meaning in the south of the Basque Country, within the Spanish state, but also in the north of the Basque Country, within the French state. We are at the moment the second biggest party in the Basque country in terms of votes and representatives in local and also autonomy institutions.
Tell me a bit about yourself. What attracted you to the Basque National Movement? You were born in a family which was already politicized, or what?
Well, in the Basque country, I was born 1977, so just after Franco died.
So your birth was a celebration of the end of Franco.
That's it. My name is Gorka, and that's a sign, because previously it was not possible or legal to have Basque names. I come from a family who has been more or less active in politics, but in the Basque country we are. My generation belongs to families on which, for many generations, peace has not been known in our homes. My grandfather was fought in the Spanish Civil War, etc., etc. So I was born in those circumstances. For many, especially for those that do not know much about the Basque country, I was born under a democratic scenario in the Spanish state, but still, and not knowing myself Francoism, and not knowing myself the repression of the Francoist system against the Basque country, I was myself very active politically from the very beginning, because I could sense, I could feel that I was being treated, and I was in itself a second-class citizen in the Basque country. A second-class citizen because I spoke a language that was not fully recognized and still is not fully recognized. A second citizen because I could not stand or promote freely those ideas I wanted to. And slowly, I became involved in politics. First in the student movement, then in the youth movement in the Basque country, and later on in the political party. I worked in the European Parliament from 2001 to 2004, and then since then I've been without any stop representing the Abertzale left internationally.
You know, many Spanish intellectuals who once used to be on the left and then shifted their political positions and moved rightwards with PSOE and even the PSE, the Spanish Communist Party, almost tried to forget the past. They didn't want to remember it, that this was a country with a past. And yet in Catalonia and the Basque country, this sense of history is very strong. Why? After all, the Civil War also took place in Castile, you know, in Madrid. But it's in Catalonia and the Basque country that the memories of the history, not just their own history, but the history of the Spanish state is very strong.
Yeah, I think there are several reasons for that. One is a very simple reason. We're not Spanish. We're not Spanish, we're not French. We Basques, we are Catalans. Then the repression against us, we have suffered repression as the rest of the Spanish people, but there was something plus, something extra in the repression against us. It was the repression against us as a people. And that repression, that lack of acknowledgement of us as a people, of the right to decide, has been or has created as well a more stronger resistance towards Spanish and French policies towards the years. So I will say that one of the reasons is we are a people. We are not better, we're not worse than Spanish. We don't hate Spain, but we want to be respected as a people, as equals. We want to decide what kind of relation we want to have with Spain and France. And unless that is accepted, and that's a principle, a democratic principle. A democratic principle positive not only for nationalists, but also for non-nationalists. It has to be the base of a good relationship.
Gorka, thank you very much.
No, thank
very
you.
Very interesting interview. Thank you.
Thank you.